Hello friends, in today's mains Maxima session, we will take 5 questions from the internal security and environment topics from the paper 3 of mains syllabus. Before we approach into understanding the question and presenting an answer for this, an important point need to be considered. For a mains question, a mere content will not be suffice. The content has to be amended. The content has to be molded and content has to be changed according to the needs of the question. So, what is important to prepare towards UPSC mains examination is not only to read but also how to understand the question and write accordingly. So, we will try to reflect this exercise in all the future sessions. So, let us take the first question. The security problems in Jammu and Kashmir is undergoing a tectonic shift. So they are trying to bring a different idea here, causing counter-insurgency operations a difficult exercise to conduct. So what are the identifiable features of this problem? So what is the problem is have been reflected in the previous statement, which is a tectonic shift, which makes the counter-insurgency operations an Herculean task. The main reason here is a counter-insurgency operation is usually being conducted by the armed forces along with police forces and is mostly an offensive strategy. But in Jammu and Kashmir, this counter-insurgency operations now facing a hardship because they were fighting against not only insurgents but the very common man, the citizen, the people living in the Jammu and Kashmir. This is the main reason why conducting such operations becoming a very difficult exercise, which often results in human rights violations, encounter deaths, and various other administrative issues. So it is this the question called this as a problem, and what are the features of this problem, and what were the steps to resolve it. An introduction should reflect the theme of the question. So the Kashmir insurgency since 1980s. So this is the beginning of the Kashmir insurgency in the modern sense. So the Kashmir insurgency, which has begun since 1980, is undergoing a phase transition. The phase transition is in the nature of people's protest rather than an insurgent activity. So this is the first shift that is occurring, which is making it very important to understand. And this changing nature of militancy poses an uncertainty on rules of engagement by the security forces. So there is a changing nature of protest which is directly participated by the people, which in turn makes the uncertainty on the rules of engagement by the security establishment. So the involvement of citizens protests in the form of stone pelting, in the form of blockade, have in fact started by 2008. But even though it started in 2008, it got aggravated since the death of Burhan Wani in 2016. So as the question asks, what are the identifiable features? Some important identifiable features of Jammu and Kashmir insurgency here is the role of non-state actors who wreaks havoc in the Jammu and Kashmir, who emanates from outside the India's borders. So the role of non-state actors across the western border is considered to be a very important unique feature, which is not a characteristic feature of other insurgent activities such as left-wing extremism and the insurgency in the northeastern India. The second unique feature is the state and the symbols of the state are perceived with a deep skepticism, are perceived with a deep doubt, which in turn receives a bullish and hostile treatment from the locals. A case to point is that the special treatment conferred to the Jammu and Kashmir in the form of constitutional protection through Article 35A and the ongoing battle about the validity of this act is a case to refer here. So there is a deep skepticism which in turn receives a bullish and a hostile treatment from the locals. So this also makes the counter-insurgency operations a difficult exercise. The third important unique feature is rather indirectly and sometimes directly, there is a growing public support for the insurgency. This growing support for the insurgency usually comes in the form of stone pelting. Now, this is a very important characteristic feature An insurgency is now characterized not by arms and weapons and bullets. It is an insurgency characterized by stone throwing citizens. Even in a more casual way, in 2016, our army chief have commented that it would have been far easier if they have taken arms and the army would have responded in an appropriate way. Because they were using stones, it become hard to respond back appropriately. So this third feature is in fact very unique for the Jammu and Kashmir insurgency. And the last unique feature is the use of social media as a propaganda tool to further the violent agenda and to help young youths towards militarism. There were various reports from the government, particularly National Investigative Agency, which has filed a charge sheet in Delhi High Court about the role of separatist leaders in using WhatsApp and WhatsApp groups to negatively motivate the youths and mobilize them towards violence. So the use of social media, even though it is prevalent throughout the country, it has been excessively used for wrong purposes in Jammu and Kashmir. So considering these unique features, what were the solutions, which is what the question asked in the third part of it. What are the steps to do? The first step that needs to be done is deployment of new socio-cultural resources. It has often been pointed out that the protests are mostly being carried out by school-going and college students. So providing a sense of security and providing opportunities for employable skills needs to be taken at a war front. It is in that context that government have taken recently steps, commendable steps, such as Udan and Himayat schemes. So these measures should be upscaled and it has to be implemented in its fullest spirit. The second needs to be that the operational culture on how these counter-insurgency exercises are conducted needs to be more reflective of the democratic principles. So it is by mainstreaming peace negotiations and ceasefire operations, the nature of the security operations and how they are conducted need to undergo a change. This change can be brought by mainstreaming peace negotiations and ceasefire operations, such as Ramadan ceasefire operations 2018, which was very successful in bringing down not only the casualties for civilians and armed forces, but also stone pelting incidents. So there need a change on how the military operations are conducted. It has to be conducted on the platform of peace, but not during an ambience of uncertainty and fear. As we already noted down, that a unique feature is the role of external non-state actors, Jammu and Kashmir insurgency, diplomatic channels with the Pakistan, and normalizing tensions at the border also should be a part of the strategy. The use of lethal forces have been a motivation cause for the people to spill into the streets. So the use of lethal forces should be the last resort, and non-lethal forces such as power shell, tear gas or water cannon should be used. A review of working of Armed Forces Special Powers, Jammu and Kashmir Act 1990 should be taken, and also the previous recommendations should be seriously considered and implemented according to the situations prevailing in the ground. In this context, the Jeevan Reddy Commission of 2004, which recommends for periodic revisal for the implementation of APSA, Jammu and Kashmir Act 1990, is important to note down. So to end this aspect, that Jammu and Kashmir insurgency is a unique threat which initially began as a militant aggression but later transformed in the recent times as a people's movement. So such a people's movement against a state should be dealt very carefully, And this can be done only by fostering unity and fraternity. This is the only way to bring lasting peace to the region. Let's move to the second question. This question also related to the internal security. Now, this question reflects a grave threat our present Indian society are facing in the form of misinformation campaign in the name of fake news and the casualties out of its fallout. Let's understand the question first, then move on to the answer. The spread of misinformation in this digital age is no longer limited to the online world, but can spill into the real world too. It is more of setting the stage for the question. In the light of recent spate of violence triggered by the spread of rumors, which are unsubstantiated facts or doctored truths, discuss how fake news is becoming a challenge to social order. As soon as we see this question, we should not jump into answering or presenting our views about fake news. This question should be dealt only from the context of how it is a challenge to the social order and how that has to be curbed. So this is not a generic question about the fake news, but a specific question about how fake news can be related to the social order. So let's see how can we make an attempt for this question. This is introduction for the question, more like setting the stage on what we are going to discuss. So fake news and spreading misinformation is not a new phenomenon, but existed in various forms. This various forms existed in the form of tales, fables, gossips, sometimes mythical stories. Most of this news, rather fake, is known to be humorous in nature and innocuous, and it doesn't cause any harm. But fabricated and manipulated content is now gaining steam, which leads to the possibility of potential violence and impacting society. So this is what the introduction is. Yes, fake news is not new to the Indian society, but in the recent times, it is causing an unprecedented violence and unpredictable consequences to the society. So this could be the introduction for this question. The question asks, in what way that it can affect the social order? Let's continue with the analysis. According to India Spin Report 2018, about 24 persons have been killed in mob attacks in the year 2016 to 2017, mainly on the basis of rumors of child lifting. Now, child lifting has become a sole reason to spread the rumors, which in turn causes the death of the so-called homeless, poor, beggars, and tribals also. So this spike in this lynches is a follow-up, in fact, of bovine-related hate violence that our country is witnessing since the death of Muhammad Akhlaq in 2016. So, according to experts, both political and social, the increasing violence in India is mainly due to the rise in socio-political and religious cleavages, which in turn led to a theme of growing intolerance. Because of the cleavages which led to intolerance is one of the prime reasons why the violence is increasing. A rise of vigilantism. Now, this rise of vigilantism is a very important aspect that should be reflected in this answer, because vigilantism will grow when the hope, when the trust on the legal mechanisms existing to bring the wrongs to the book is failing or seem to be failing. That is why vigilantism grows. So this is what an important reflection we will have to bring it in our answer in this question. And an apparent atmosphere of impunity for the attackers. An impunity for the attackers is mainly on the ground that because it is a mob violence, fixing and responsibility on who made the kill becomes hard. So the crime got diffused, and it becomes very hard for the police to prove the culpability of the crime, and hence it results in most of the cases the perpetrated criminals were left off the hook. This also gives a sense of impunity. What I want to reiterate here is, this is a video to explain the concepts of behind using a particular terminologies here. You don't need to write such a lengthy answer, But this is an answer, this is a session to elaborate on what is given. If you written only this statement that socio-political and religious cleavages, a rise of vigilantism and an atmosphere of impunity for attackers will suffice to suit for this question. Now, in what way it impacts the social order, which I have said is what the crux of the question. One, the social order in fact is a fragile. Social order is always a fragile and rests on delicate balance between various factors. And one of the most important factor that maintains the balance is a belief on the justice system. So, a growing rise of this vigilantism based on mob violence is an indication that there is a disbelief on the justice system which is right now seen by the Indian society. So, first impact, growing disbelief. The second is taking law unto themselves in the name of instant justice will tear away the social fabric of coexistence. So, this is another dire consequences of this growing violences, that rather than coexistence, it is the self-interest at the cost of others is promoted. The third impact is anti-justice. Even though it has a word justice, it is not a justice at all. It is to be better called as a vigilante crime. It is not a justice at all, but a group crime against a helpless victim. Now, in the 24 deaths being reported across the nation, that is one common ground seen among them all. They are all outsiders to the areas where the crime was perpetrated. So, the next impact on the social order is much of this violence acts on the plank of insider-outsider view. So, any unknown person who is visiting an area, particularly if they look poor, if they look homeless, or if they are mentally retarded, they are perceived as child lifters, or they are perceived as robbers. And in the climate of fake news, which creates a sense of fear, it motivates unaware people towards violence. So, this is a third impact on the social order. Vasudeva Kudumbagam has now become distorted to view every new person, every unknown person as suspected or potential criminals. That's a third impact on the social order. The next is, this fake news, it affects not only the victims, it also affects the members psychologically. It also takes away their conscience and they are provoked to act like a robot based on knee-jerk responses. The mob violence is also justified as heroism to protect their own. Now, this in fact is an indication of people have lost faith in law enforcement and criminal justice systems. So, such a losing faith in the law of the land is a serious threat to the society. Ways that how fake news will affect the social order. How can we put an end to this? In this menace of fake news and the related violence, there are three actors involved. The one, the government. The second, the society, and the third, the so-called intermediaries called as platforms, social media platforms. So, any such measure should involve all the three stakeholders. So, our answer should reflect at least one measure that deals with these three stakeholders. The first one, in terms of intermediaries. Even though IT Act 2008 has imposed limited liability on the intermediaries. IT Act 2008 imposed only limited liability on the intermediaries. Nevertheless, the growing violences in fact have worried Facebook and WhatsApp management, and they have taken recently various measures towards this. So, in this context, Facebook and WhatsApp have taken recent measures such as limiting the total number of forwards one can do is a worthy step. Similarly, these intermediaries should be more forthcoming and they should not defend themselves in the name of freedom of expression, because here the freedom of expression need to be justified with the right to life of the victims under Article 21. So they should be more forthcoming and take steps, more rewarding steps, and cooperate with the law enforcement agencies to nab those who spread this fake news. The second, from the perspective of the government, there are two important legal measures with which fake news can be handled. The IPC section 153A and 295 comes to the rescue to handle the fake news, the spread of the fake news and the rumors. But section 153A and 295 does not define what a fake news is, and hence there need to be suitable amendments carried out to bring clarity on what constitutes hate speech and what constitutes fake news and the resultant violence. This can help in better handling of the crimes by the law enforcement authorities. The third is the change that needs to be brought among the people. Misinformation should be handled by more information. So there has to be creation of awareness about the taking law onto their own hands in the name of instant justice. So such irresponsible behavior is against the law of the land, and an awareness on these aspects must be regularly uptaken in the major dailies, and the implication of these acts should be reflected in these awareness campaigns. So the conclusion on this is such that the constitutional guarantee of right to express ideas and thoughts freely under Article 69 must not violate the right to life of Article 21. So a balance must be sought, and the government should not also be equally prejudiced and act knee-jerk by curtailing the right to freedom. A balance should be brought between both these indispensable rights, and by bringing justice to the victims of this violence, that a sense of justice can prevail in the society, which helps to deal with this menace in the long run. The constitutional articles guaranteeing freedom must be ensured that they don't violate each other. So Article 19, which provides right to express freely, must not violate the right to live under Article 21. So a balance should be understood by the society as well as by the government, so that only by bringing justice to these victims that these issues can be dealt in the long run. The third question is related to paper 3, but it is a topic which cannot be attributed to either internal security or environment or governance. It is a topic which can be fit into any crevice. So let's see the question. Do you think that the road safety be considered as a public health problem in India? Substantiate your view and provide measures. So let's try to understand the question first. What the question demands? The question asks whether road safety is a public health problem or not. Unhealthy food habits leading to non-communicable diseases have been identified as a public health problem because these gives rise to rising number of mortality and the morbidity. It does not bode well to the development of the country. So in this context, can we consider road safety also as a public health problem? So our answer should reflect, if you consider road safety as a public health problem, you need to provide points justifying it. If you don't consider road safety as a public health problem, you have to justify. It is not much of a significance. It is probably one of the causes for the mortalities that we witness. But the nature of the very question here gives us a hint that it is indeed a public health problem. So it is always safer to adopt in a positive sense rather than going in a negative sense, which in fact you are free to adopt approach. But it's always better to think that yes, road safety is a public health problem in India. We have to substantiate it, and how can we deal with it? So introduction. According to World Health Organization fact sheet in 2017, road injuries causes 65% more ill health, disabilities and early deaths in 2016 than 1990. Compared to 1990, in 2016, there is a growing number of ill health, disabilities and early deaths. One of the main reasons why there is a growth of 95% is because of urbanization, the rising number of fleets in the roads, along with that how people and government have handled this, the increasing demands of urbanization. That is the reason why in 1990 there were less number of mortality and morbidity than 2016. Now this in fact gives an indirect hint. In 2016, if it causes 65% more health problems than 1990, how much problems it is going to cause in 2030 if unaddressed? So yes, we are giving a hint that it is going to be, if not now, it is going to be a major public health problem. From Indian context, road fatalities constitutes 16.6% of all deaths, making it sixth leading cause. So in terms of mortality, road accidents is a sixth leading cause, which is in no way smaller. And compared to China, India is next to China in terms of road related deaths. So these points projects the magnitude of the problem about the road safety and the loss of lives. Now we have to take a stance whether is it a public health problem or not. And in this answer, yes, road safety is a public health problem. Now we have to justify them. How? Generally, there was a traditional view that road crashes are due to human errors. Road crashes are due to human errors, such as insensitive driving behavior or indiscipline in the lanes, in shifting lanes, or tired driving. There are various reasons cited for the major causes of road crashes. But it is often believed that it is in fact belongs to the traditional view. It lacks a scientific approach. Because the traditional view considered human error as a major reason, a scientific approach for the road safety have been long missing. Because we considered as a human error, scientific approach on this problem was long missing. So it is with the growth of understanding on the magnitude of the dimensions why a road accident occurs that we are coming to understand that road safety and road accidents can be approached scientifically, which makes us to consider that it is in fact a public health matter of public health importance. The second reason why we have to consider it as a public health importance: the ongoing, the rapid urbanization that we witness in the country, along with increasing traffic and fleets, vehicles on the road, is a reality that we cannot escape. So, in the context of rapid urbanization and more vehicles on the road, there is bound to be an increase of road accidents in the future. Unless we consider road safety as a public health importance, unless we consider it as a public health importance, that ensuring safety for the users could not be guaranteed. So, the number of vehicles, according to an independent evaluation, the growth of vehicles in the Indian roads is extremely fast. In fact, very nearing to the number of human heads added every year. And there are expected to be about 170 million vehicles on the roads in the country. 170 million roads. So such a rapid increase is bound to cause more troubles. So considering all these facts, that India is a fast urbanizing nation, and that is also growth, a rapid growth of vehicles, and with other ancillary factors, road safety should be considered as a public health importance only upon which the government together with the society can take sustainable steps to ensure the safety. So it will provoke the government by considering it as a public health importance. It will provoke the government and sensitize the people to act responsibly and initiate measures to crack the whip. This is the reason why that road safety should be considered as a public health importance. The question asked what are the measures needed to ensure the road safety? The measure should start first with citizens, the people who use roads. Petty crimes are not considered seriously, and over a period of time, the petty crimes snowballs into a huge crisis. Smaller crimes such as aggressive driving, use of cell phone while driving, drunken driving, use of high beams, rash driving are the common practices, and the offenders are rarely caught. They are usually caught and made to stand in the court of law only when there is a loss of lives or when there is an injury involved. So this sense of impunity must be addressed. The sense of impunity for petty crimes should be addressed. Even a traffic violations should be very seriously considered. In this regard, the strict implementation of Motor Vehicles Act 1988 should be undertaken by the traffic police. The second is to create awareness among the youngsters at the school level and at the college level. There were various deaths reported not only in the Indian roads but also on other transportation modes due to the insensitive travelling behaviour of school students and the college goers. So creating rules, creating awareness about the dangers of this unsafe travelling should be brought on. And in this exercise, there has to be an engagement with the civil society, such as NGOs. So NGOs should be roped in along with the community leaders to bring awareness among the youngsters at the school and the college level. To cite an example here, few years back in Kerala, the Transport Commissioner Rishi Raj have deployed electronic instrumentation for monitoring and enforcement of traffic rules. This introduction of technology on monitoring the traffic violations have significantly brought down the traffic violations to about 40%. So there is a proof that the use of technology can significantly address the traffic violations, which in turn brings an awareness, which in turn will help in reducing the deaths due to the unsafe driving practices. The next important measure is with the context of Indian Road Safety Index 2017. Indian Road Safety Index 2017. This is a very crucial index in this context and have expressed serious lacunae on the design, the implementation and the maintenance of the Indian roads. And after analyzing this lacunae, they have provided various recommendations and measures on to improve the situation. So these recommendations should be incorporated in the design of the road infrastructure in the country on schemes such as JNNURM. Smart Cities Mission, which involves improvising the urban infrastructure, should integrate with scientific road planning and engineering in mind. In addition to this, roads have become unsafe not only to the drivers but also to the pedestrians. So safety to the pedestrians should be considered by putting an imperative on having zebra crossings on busy roads, cycling tracks and no vehicle days. In addition to this, it is also necessary to eliminate corruption in the transport departments. The corruption in the transport departments resulted in the poor quality of licensing system, which makes unqualified and unethical drivers on the roads who causes accidents. It also results in poor monitoring of roadworthiness of commercial vehicles also. So the corruption in these two aspects must be addressed so that the road safety can be a viable step ahead. As a conclusion, India have acceded the recommendations and Brasilia Declaration for Road Safety 2015 have the aim of reducing traffic accidents, road accidents have the aim of reducing road accidents by half by the year 2020. So Indian government have adopted the Brasilia declaration, which is in fact and indeed a welcome move. The key lies in its faithful implementation and bringing along with it various other measures such as IRSI 2017 recommendations should be a worthy step ahead.